Hello teacher educators, today we'll discuss about eminent biologist contributions and reflections on society. Here, if we look at this slide, around 600 BC, the Greeks began the age of theoretical science. A science is based on logical thinking and reasoning according to the Greeks. But as the records available in later periods indicates, the Hindus were already familiar with some science, like a Greek, probably of the Babylonians too. Here, Atreya, Sushruta, and Charaka in medicine and surgery are the important names of Indian history and important names in the history of science in India. But here, if we observe these people's contributions towards science in India, first we'll observe the Atreya's Punarvasu contributions. He was a renowned scholar of Ayurveda, and based on his teachings, here six schools of early Ayurveda was founded based on his teachings only. But the original contents of Charaka Samhita are credited by Agnivesha and Charaka. His major contribution is in the field of Ayurveda, as Charaka Samhita is regarded as a foundation text of Ayurveda. But here, if we'll observe the next person, Sushruta, if we'll observe his contribution, he was an ancient Indian physician. He wrote Sushruta Samhita, which is an ancient Sanskrit text on medicine and surgery also. Then here, Sushruta's major contribution is in the field of surgery. He was the first person who invented the surgery. Then the next person is Charaka. If you'll observe his contributions, Charaka is known as the Indian father of medicine. He confined Charaka Samhita. It is the most important ancient text in Ayurveda, but his major contribution was in the field of Ayurveda only. These three people contributed a lot to the science in India. Then next we'll observe the objectives. Here, the first objective is to know the work of eminent biologists, then what work they contributed in the biological science subject, how they contributed. We'll get to know through this chapter. And here, to realize the selfless efforts put by the scientists, the most of the scientists, they contributed their life towards the science to discoveries and inventions of biological science, and not only the biological science, whatever the disciplines they are involving in, their contributions are a lot. Sometimes even they lost their life also to give something to the society. Then the third objective is to enhance the appreciation skills among the learners about the contributions of biologists. Here, then whatever the things we observe, whatever the things we are learning through the biological science discipline, then these things are helps to develop the appreciation skills of the learners, to give respect to the work of the scientist. This is the next objective. Then here, the most important objective is to develop the scientific attitude and scientific temper through the works of the scientist. Okay, if you are going through the science experiments or science phenomena, or if we are observing anything is happening, any photosynthesis or anything in the laboratory or a natural settings, then our mind, body, soul are involved to learn that and observe that. Through this learning, the learners will develop the scientific attitude and scientific temper. For this, the sciences helps us to develop these two things especially. This is the most important objective. If you'll observe the next objective, to acquire the nature of scientists to do work for a society. Here, the children are also acts as a scientist. They'll give the respect to the works of and contributions of the scientists, as well as they develop the scientific attitude and scientific temper. Even they adopt, they acquire the nature of scientists. They behave like a scientist to observe the society and to work anything like that. That the last objective is to know the development of science from ancient days to contemporary, means how the science is developing from ancient period to till now. There is a lot of development is taking place in a science when compared to the ancient days to till now. The gradual development and the drastic development is taking place in a science. These are the objectives of science, contributions of scientists towards India. Then if we'll observe the William Harvey, he was born in England in 1578 and he completed his degree from the Cambridge University, and he also studied the medicine from University of Padua. He has two medical degrees. Then he graduated honors in 1602. Then again he finished his another medical degree from the Cambridge University. Then we'll observe his contributions. Here, Harvey is fascinated by the way of blood flow through the human body. Then means here how the blood is flowing throughout the human body. He wants to know, then he wants to give the what is the mechanism, how the blood flow throughout the human body. Then and those days the people are believed, they thought that the food was converted into blood by the liver. Means liver is a reason to food is converted into the blood, like that they believe. Then and it was consumed as a fuel by the body. This is the thought of the people at that particular period. But here Harvey knew this was untrue, means this is not correct. But how he has given this word which is not true, means through his first hand observations of humans and animal dissections, he got to know this statement is not true. Which statement is not true means the food was converted into blood not by the liver. Okay, then here it is not consumed as a fuel. This statement is wrong according to the Harvey's contribution, because he had the first hand experience of dissection of animals as well as the humans. Then here he published a book. The name of the book is the an anatomical study of the motion of the heart and of the blood in animals. How the the blood motion in a heart and the animals. In 1628 he has published this book, and which is explained how blood was pumped from the heart throughout the body and again it returns to the heart and recirculated. This process is explained in this particular book. Then it was very controversial, but it became the basis for all modern research on the heart and blood vessels. Later on, this is the foundation. This will help to the many scientists to know about the heart and blood vessels and blood flow even. The next thing is, at some point, his attention was turned to the reproduction also. He concentrated on reproduction also, how the reproduction is taking place like that. Then he has some speculation. Then here he speculated that the humans and other animals must reproduce through the joining of an egg and sperm. That is his speculation. But here it was 200 years before a mammalian egg was finally observed. Here the second groundbreaking book published by the Harvey in 1651 is Essay on the Generation of Animals, is considered the basis for modern embryology. This book, which is nothing but Essay on the Generation of Animals, is based for the modern embryology. Modern embryology is evolved based on this particular book only. Then he was recognized as a medical leader in his day. At that particular time, he treated as a medical leader because he has interest in so many areas. His contributions are very much useful and thought-provoking thing. That is the reason he was recognized as a medical leader in his day. Then he was a doctor to King Charles I of England, and he was appointed doctor of physic at Oxford. Okay, here the major difference between Harvey and his predecessors was methodology. The methodology is different, but the approach is, means the people who works on the same things, the ways, the methods are different, but the final destination is same for all the scientists. But in his fact book, nothing would go down in his fact book unless tested. He's very particular about testing, and he would readily remove it if it did not out on a retest. If it is failed for the retest, he cannot consider that it is worthy. Like that, he removed it from that particular thing. Then Harvey was the first to adopt the scientific method for the solution of biological science problems. First, he invented the scientific method how to deal the biological science problems, or how to give solutions to the biological science problems. The next scientist, these are the contributions of William Harvey. The next scientist is Jean-Baptiste Lamarck. He was a French naturalist. He was a soldier, biologist, as well as academic, and an early proponent of idea that evolution occurred and proceeded in accordance with natural laws. That is his opinion. Then after being injured in army in 1760, he returned to the medical studies. He returned to the medical studies after being injured in army. Then if we look at his contributions, in 1801 he published Systema des Animax, Sense Vertebrates, a major work on classification of invertebrates. Okay, this is published in 1801. Then he categorized echinoderms, arachnids, crustaceans, and annelids, which he separated from old taxon from worms known as worms. Now we are calling it as a worms, then before worms, like that. Okay, he first used the term biology in modern sense. The first person, Jean-Baptiste Lamarck, coined the term biology. Then if you'll observe more contributions of Lamarck in modern era, Lamarck is widely remembered for the theory of inheritance of acquired characteristics called soft inheritance. Then here, philosophic zoology in 1809 gives Lamarckism, means use or disuse theory. This explains about use or disuse theory. Here Lamarck published hydrogeologic in 1802. It is advocated a steady state geology. It is based on strict uniformitarianism. And more contributions, if you'll observe, the Lamarck stressed two main themes in his biological work. The first thing is environment gives rise to change in animals, for example, blindness in moles, and the presence and absence of teeth in animals. These statements are, these examples are, comes under environments give rise to change in animals, means environment influences the presence or absence of teeth in animals, and blindness of moles will also observe. Then the second thing is life was structured in an orderly manner, and that made different parts of all bodies make it possible for the organic movements of animals. This is the second thing. Then here he was the first to develop a truly coherent evolutionary theory. Lamarck was the first person to develop the evolutionary theory. He argued that the organism moves from simple organisms but never disappear, because they were constantly being created by spontaneous generation in what has been described as a steady state biology. We discussed about steady state biology. Then that is his argument. But then whatever the organisms moves from simple organisms, but they never disappear because they were constantly being created. Means the continuous generation or development is taking place by the spontaneous generation. Means they like that they generated. That is his argument. Then this we describe as a steady state biology. Then here the second component of the theory of evolution was the adaptations of organisms to this environment. Adaptations of organisms to this environment. Whatever the environment we are living in, some adaptations are taking place to adjust to that particular environment, the particular environment to live, to survive, like that. In this, the first law, if you observe the first law, in every animal which has not passed the limit of its development, more frequently and continuous use of any organ gradually strengthens and develops and enlarges. That organ, it develops and it strengthens and it enlarges also. Means because here that particular organ is used continuously, but it gives its power proportional to the length of the time has been used. So means here how much time you are used that organism or organ, it will sustain a long time. Then if you'll observe here the slide, the originally the giraffe has short-necked ancestor, but the need means then it stretching further leaves, higher places leaves, then finally it stretched, means for the environment purpose it stretched, the neck is stretched. This is the example. And here the permanent disuse of any organ imperceptibly weakens and deteriorates it, and it progressively diminishes its functional capacity and finally disappears. Then in previously what we discovered, whatever the organs we are used continuously, it develops, it enlarges and it strengthens, it sustains a long time. Then like that, whatever the organ which is not used continuously, then what we are observing here, it weakens automatically, it deteriorates and it progressively diminishes and disappears. Here if we'll observe the blacksmith, a blacksmith throughout his work strengthens his muscles because of the nature of work he's doing to strengthen his muscles, and when they mature it develops. Then here with the modern discovery of DNA, we can say that the Lamarck's theory was wrong, because here but he put the basis for Darwin's evolution theory, which is considered the most important. Means whatever the work they are doing, because of that particular thing the muscles are developed, later they mature. But according to the modern discovery of DNA, it should be wrong. But DNA decides the muscles have to be there or not. Then here if you'll observe the second law, all the acquisitions or losses wrought by their nature on individuals through the influence of environment in which these rays have long been placed, thanks to the influence of the predominant use or predominant disuse of any organ. If you'll observe the second law here, the Lamarck's theory of evolution, here the traits, if we observe the clip ears and tails of the dog could be passed to the offsprings. Means whatever the nature or characteristics of the organ are there for that particular animal, it passes to the next generation. This is the second principle, second law. Okay, traits acquired during one's lifetime would be passed to offsprings. Whatever the traits will be there till the end of his or her or the animal's life, it passes to the next generation. This is the second law. Then these things about the Lamarck's contributions. The next person is Charles Darwin. Then the Charles Robert Darwin was born at Shrewsbury on 12 February 1809. His father was Robert Darwin and mother was Susanna Darwin, and his father was a doctor. At that time, his father was a doctor. Darwin first studied medicine at Edinburgh. Then he taught that he is not interested in medicine. Then he transferred to Cambridge. Okay. Then the Darwin is the first evolutionary biologist. Okay. The Darwin is the first evolutionary biologist. First evolution concept is given by the Darwin, and also English naturalist and geologist. If you observe the scientists in the ancient days, they were specialized in many areas: biologist, naturalist, and geologist. He was the originator of the concept of natural selection. We'll see what is the natural selection further. Then he went on a voyage for 5 years and a world survey ship of British government, HMS Beagle, and explored flora and fauna of number of continents and islands. Flora and fauna, he explored. Flora is nothing but plants. Fauna is nothing but about animals. He explored the number of continents and islands to observe all those things. Then in 1859, Darwin's Shuddering Work was The Origin of Species. That is his book. Okay, The Origin of Species was his book. It is now regarded as a leading work on natural philosophy and in history of a mankind. That is the base for to do lots of research. And here, after spending time on island, the Darwin developed a theory which implies that all species derived from common ancestors through a process called natural selection. His major opinion is all the species derived from common ancestors. That phenomenon is called as a natural selection. This is given by Darwin. It is the biggest factor resulting in the diversity of species and their genomes. Then we'll observe the theory of natural selection. According to the Darwin, the individual possessing harmfully variation and reproductively less successful, the organisms with beneficial variation would increase the ability to reproduce and leave more fertile offspring. Means here, they are said to be fittest organisms and they can only survive. The organisms with less reproductive success is not represented in future generations. Then we'll observe more about this. Here, Herbert Spencer called this phenomenon as the survival of the fittest. Survival of the fittest. They have to, if there are less number of animals, they'll survive in a successful manner. If there are more, their surviving is the difficult. Like that. In other words, the natural selection doesn't produce genetic changes. But once genetic changes occurred, it favors some genetic changes while rejecting others. The evidences for natural selection. Evidence for natural selection. The first evidence is overpopulation. Every organism tends to increase its population in large proportions. For example, salmon fish produces 28 million eggs. If all these eggs are hatched to grow larva to reproductive age, all the seas filled with these salmon fish only for few generations. This is overpopulation. The one evidence is for overpopulation. Then the other evidence is constancy in population. However, such an abnormal increase is not noticed in the population of any species in nature, as the offspring die in large number before reaching the reproductive age. Okay, constancy in population. Okay, before reaching the reproductive age, most of the offspring will die. Means the constancy, the stability will be there to some extent of population on the earth or on this planet. The food and the other sources do not increase the same proportion as the population increases. That is the reason, according to the food and according to the what is that, the shelter and other sources, not for that purpose, these sources are not increased with respect to the increase in the population. So here we'll observe, till they reach the age of reproduction, most of the animals will die. And means not most, means not all, the stability in a population will be maintained with the proportional to food and other sources. This is about the constancy in population. Then third thing is struggle for existence. As the food sources are limited, severe competition exists among the numbers of population, and Darwin called it struggle for existence, which are three types. Here the third principle is struggle for existence. Okay, here as the food sources are limited, the competition is more to exist. Who will fight and get their food? They are the energetic and they are the powerful, like that. Okay, here these are of the three types. Intraspecific struggle. The first struggle is intraspecific struggle. The second thing is interspecific struggle, and the third thing is struggle with environment. We'll observe the first struggle, that is nothing but intraspecific struggle. The competition found among individuals of the same species is for food, shelter, and mate. The fighting between the same species for food, shelter, and mate. This is called as a intraspecific struggle. That interspecific struggle is nothing but the competition among the animals of different species. Okay, different species animals are fighting each other for food and shelter, is called as the intraspecific struggle. The final struggle is struggle with environment. All the living organisms are struggling with the adverse environmental conditions, such as cyclones, floods, natural disasters. All these things, with all these things, the species or organisms are fighting for existence. This struggle is called as a struggle with environment. This is the third thing. The next thing is, next contribution is Darwin finches. If we talk about the Darwin finches, here the Darwin finches are an excellent example of the way in which species gene pools have adapted for long-term survival via their offspring. How we'll observe. Here the finch has adapted to take advantage of feeding in different ecological finches. Then the finches which eat grubs have a thin extended beak to poke into the holes in the ground and extract the grubs. The grubs are under the ground, and their beak or finch have to be thickened to strong to dig into the ground and take the things to eat, means grubs to eat. Then finches which eat buds and fruits, flower related buds and fruits, would be less successful at doing this, while their claw-like beak can grind down their food. This is the second type. And he postulated that beak of ancestor species has adapted over time to equip the finches to acquire different food sources. Okay, this helped him to develop the theory of natural selection. He observed all the birds to eat their food, how their finches. So based on that, these are the finches. If you'll observe here, these are the finches of birds. If you'll observe here, the finches Okay. The next thing here, yeah, large ground finch. Till here is our, well, is it ground finches? Crushing beaks. Crushing these beaks are crushing. They're small and short. Small ground finch, medium ground finch, and large ground finch. Seed eater. These are the seed eaters. Then cactus finch. It loves of little forward, moving forward, and little longer when compared to the ground finches and crushing beaks. And here, warbler finch, probing beak. Here, sharper when compared to these things. And woodpecker finch, and small tree finch, tree finches, grasping beaks. It will these birds eat the insects, and tree finches, grasping beaks, small tree finch, large tree finch, and parrot beak. This is the parrot beak, vegetarian tree finch. Okay, these are the types of beaks. Means finches and food they eat. This is his contribution. And next thing is industrial melanism. He also did the concept of industrial melanism. The industrial melanism occurs in a species called peppered moth, white and black. Peppered moth is the opening of industrial revolution. Whenever the industrial revolution happened, then from that time, the industrial melanism happened to the peppered moth. Then what is that? We'll observe. Due to this industrial revolution, there is a change in the environment. The dough released from industries makes it three darker color. Whatever the pollution, whatever the things are, what is that produced by the industries, that productions of industries will turn the trees into darker color. As a result, the white moth appears clearly on this dark tree and it forms the food for predators. Okay, the trees become dark. The white moth is clearly visible to the predator to eat. Okay, in the same way, in non-industrial areas, as trees doesn't become black. Okay. Here the black peppered moth is clearly seen there, so it forms the food for predators. But in this instance, natural selection would favor the darker moths in polluted environment and whiter moths in lesser polluted environment. Okay, here the darker moths are presented in a polluted environment and lesser darker moths presented in a less polluted environment. Due to their ability to merge with their environmental color, means they will also become the environment according to the environment. Environmental color and less the chances of their being prone to predators. Here, if you'll observe, peppered moths, two types, dark, here the dark and light, here the dark and the light peppered moths, here. Okay, the dark, light, we are looking. Here, okay, these are the marks. Okay, when it starts the industrial revolution opens. The next contribution is sickle cell trait. It is a situation that occurs in the presence of a recessive allele coding for hemoglobin, which is nothing but it is a substance in a blood responsible for the transport of gases like oxygen transporter. This substance is that is called as the recessive allele coding. The presence of allele is either partially expressed recessively or fully expressed by a complete recessive expression, which results in full blown anemia. Here, if this particular allele is dominant, no sickle cell trait is expressed in phenotype. Above occurrence in the case of recessive allele results in structural defects of red blood cells, severely reducing the organism capacity to uptake oxygen. This is a normal blood cell. The flow is very easy if it is like this. If it is a sickle cell like structure, then we'll see how they flow. Here, the normal red blood cell, these are the normal red blood cells. spherical in shape. They are moving very easily. Then here, if we cut, okay, the normal blood cell section. This is the normal hemoglobin, the second order blood structure. Then here, if we'll observe the sickle cell like structure here, we'll observe the flow is stopped and blocked. It's not flow like the normal cells. Here, abnormal hemoglobin is also forms. Okay, this is the difference between sickle cell and normal blood cells. Then here, the later, these are the contributions of Darwin. Then Darwin later, he became heart failure and he was died in 19th April 1882 in his home. Thank you.